Many people best believe that it is in the East that techniques of self-defense have reached their highest expression, and especially in Japan. Ancient fighting skills that were developed hundreds of years ago are still used today and are practiced with the same dedication and discipline. The Japanese self-defense masters devised and developed a series of techniques that teach an unarmed man how to disarm an armed man, even if he's threatening him with a knife or dagger.
Traditionally, there is no distinction between unarmed combat and armed combat in Japan. And indeed, the unarmed combat forms which are practiced and studied today in Japan derive from traditions born from armed combat. So methods of disarming swordsmen, which are practiced in Aikido and Judo today, of course, were originated in the sword fencing schools.
There are a series of key sword play movements that were first developed in the fencing schools over 700 years ago.
It was quite a shock, you know, in the 19th century when Yukio Tani, a diminutive Japanese judo man, came to this country and was able to take on all comers at wrestling and defeat them with ease.
It is this particular quality of Japanese martial arts that the West finds so fascinating, that any individual can learn to overcome an aggressive assailant.
Then, as now, it has captured people's imagination that a small man, a weak man, or an old man can defeat a younger, stronger, more violent man.
To Western eyes, these are familiar, unarmed self-defense techniques, but in the East, they think about them differently.
In a way, I suppose you could say that self-defense is a misnomer, because the ultimate aim of the Japanese martial arts is to indulge in combat without regard to one's own life.
The sword was completely central to the Japanese military tradition. Practicing for warfare with the sword was a daily routine for the samurai warriors of the 11th and 12th centuries.
Warfare in Japan for virtually the past 1,000 years has been largely fought between members of the hereditary class, and the man in the street, as it were, had no place in this. The traditional military class in Japan, who numbered perhaps 6 or 7% of the population, went armed every day of their lives. And indeed, during the Edo period, they carried two swords. The shorter they would wear at home and even carried to their bedchamber. The longer one they would wear out of doors. So their devotion to the military training was a very, very, very much more intense thing than we can possibly imagine.
The dedication that the ancient samurai warriors brought to their fighting skills, even with wooden swords, was much more than technical expertise. Their mental approach, the state of their mind at the moment of attack, was also very important.
Their whole life was devoted to the study of the military arts. But these fighting arts became nurtured in the spirit of Buddhism, and particularly Zen Buddhism. The highest spiritual point for a samurai was to get beyond the mistaken concepts of life and death, beyond the concept of grasping for one's own life. And such people who'd attained such a spiritual level, of course, made very, very frightful opponents.
Moves and counter-moves were developed to maximise speed and mobility, and so avoid attack. Again, these are very carefully controlled and have a deeply spiritual significance.
It is the spiritual advantage which counts, and the martial arts developed into training for this spiritual advantage. And this spiritual advantage, of course, eventually became more spiritual than combative, if you like.
The Nikkoto Shogu Shrine is one of Japan's most important, dedicated to the first great shogun. Here, young Shinto priests are quietly preparing to practice the exhilarating and dynamic art of Kendo, a unique and very traditional style of Japanese fencing.
It's through Kendo swordplay, with its spiritual aspects, that one can actually study something which is beyond combat itself.
Kendo is one of the most popular of all Japanese martial arts. It uses real swordplay, but with bamboo swords, in a highly ritualized presentation.
You know that you're not going to be killed, so you can exert utmost aggression and violence against the opponent, while at the same time imagining that the bamboo sword which he holds is a real sword. It's perhaps a bit artificial, but it's the nearest one we'll get to such a spiritual edge, if you like, other than actually fighting with a real sword, which I certainly don't recommend.
The armour has an unfamiliar look to Western eyes. The jacket, or kendo gi, is cotton. The split trousers, the hakama, give complete freedom of movement, and the helmet, or men, protects the throat, shoulders, and the back of the head. Hands and hips are also covered. The priests are taught that awareness of the opponent and knowing what he may do next is the key discipline. This is achieved through clear thought and a determined spirit. Eye contact is considered crucial. The noise the fighters make is also traditional. The shout, or ki-ai, charges the fighter's adrenaline and boosts energy. Points are awarded for the accuracy of the strike. It must be the edge of the sword, not the side. Opponents call out the area of the body they intend to hit, just as they attack. Etiquette and order return at the end of the fight, and in the traditional Japanese way, each bows to the shrine, then to each other. The self-knowledge and self-discipline that characterized Japanese sword practice never became part of the Western tradition. In the West, using wooden sticks had no spiritual dimension. Instead, practice stayed just practice, or it became a sport.